Okay, hello and welcome everyone. Today we are very happy to welcome Anupama Kundu, the architect, for the fourth session of the Auroville City Conversations, to learn a little more from her about her new exhibition called Taking Time, which has just been put up at the prestigious Louisiana Museum in Denmark. So Anupama has lived in Auroville for 12 years, and during that time she was a very active participant in our community, as well as her work as an architect with public buildings like the Auroville Town Hall, then the residential communities like Creativity, and also her own home called the Wall House, which has now gained immense recognition all over the world. But after leaving Auroville, Anu has done a lot of teaching work throughout the world, in universities in Berlin, in Madrid, in Queensland, Australia, also at the Parsons School of Design in New York. And she was twice invited to participate and present her work at the Venice Biennale. And she has also authored a monograph of Roger Angier, who is the Auroville's chief architect, who was the Auroville's chief architect. So I will leave it there because Anupama's list of achievements is very, very long. So let me leave it there and introduce you to the two other people joining us in the conversation today. We have Jaya. Jaya has been part of Auroville since the 80s, and she is and has been the founder and the main coordinator of the Auroville Unity Pavilion in the International Zone. And that is exactly where the Auroville City Exhibition is happening, which is the basis of our city conversations, which we are doing now. And we are once again very happy to have Tuan Van Meegen. Tuan, as you have already met him before, is one of Auroville's pioneering members, and also someone with a lot of interest in the energy sector. He was the first to set up the Renewable Energy Group in Auroville, and he was for over a decade in senior management positions in the renewable energy sector internationally. And he continues to participate in Auroville's development, planning, infrastructure, and sustainable growth through Auroville Consulting, where he is a co-founder. So welcome to all of you. And Anu, let me go directly to you with the first question. How did this project come about with the Louisiana Museum? How long has it been in process, you know, from the time of conception to having the idea to the how it matured to be realized as it is right now? And also the theme, we can touch upon it briefly. I know Tuan wants to ask you some more in detail, but if you can touch upon the theme, Taking Time, which seems to have so many layers there. And so, welcome. Do give us your feedback, and it's an honor to have Auroville represented there as part of this exhibition. Over to you.
Thank you, Anu. Thanks, Jaya and Tuan, for being there, for taking your time to, share something that I've been busy with for a long, long time. And I suppose it's the first time I'm able to share it with my Auroville friends, what many people have seen me being around them. And all of us are very busy, but I think this is an opportunity for me, thanks to your having set it up, to be able to really share what I actually used to do and what I do and what I'm planning to do as well, and how I'm planning to spend my time, or how I've been, looking at this this whole profession of architecture, especially in the context of not only Auroville, but my at least 17 years of collaboration with Roger Angier, who completely, helped me to redefine the standards of what it is that we aspire, and all the things that I did have contributed to who I became, you know. And so I would like to, in that spirit, can I share my slides here so that it's sometimes pictures speak loud. So I mean, while this is getting enabled, I want to just say that I used to always look upon time as the most important resource of our lives, our own lifetime. And I always wondered that how come in our times it is such a underrated or undervalued resource? And what is the true cost of being in a hurry and saving time, you know? And therefore, in order to save time, we are spending all kinds of resources. We are spending natural resources in order to save human resources. Like, we don't want to spend time. We don't want to be engaged ourselves. We are outsourcing all sorts of things. And we're looking upon design as a good design as something where time was saved. But I think that kind of being in a hurry is very costly for the planet. Yeah. I can directly begin by explaining that this is an exhibition of 30 years of my work as an architect at the Louisiana Museum. This is their poster, Taking Time. Okay, I'll start here again, okay? So this is the poster of my exhibition, which you'll see all around Copenhagen and everywhere. The exhibition is called Taking Time because I gave that title because it's 30 years, 3 decades in the profession. And I want to discuss with my colleagues about this very important and underrated resource, especially in the light of sustainability. People are talking about saving all kinds of resources, but maybe not necessarily looking at how freely we are spending, maybe not for what we ought to be doing. And especially what I want to address actually is the fact that we need to change our habits, and that needs the time. I don't mean to say by taking time, I don't mean to say that to delay. It's the opposite. I feel that in our hastiness, we delay things, right? So we need to take time to recondition our habits in order to have a good life. And every minute that we did something or didn't do something is going to shape our future. And that's where we ought to be looking at sustainability through this perspective of time in order to tip it the other way around, that we spend much more human resources to be intelligent and to become more advanced. And then we can, if we spend more human resources, we could save natural resources. That's my approach. So I just want to say that, you know, Kelson, he's the most senior curator there at Louisiana. And since the last 8 years, he told me that he's been following my work. And so he came 4 years ago, in fact, to see me. And he asked me to, he wanted to invite me to produce an exhibition. And I sort of proposed this title because I never got the luxury of 4 years to produce a reflection of my work. So that's how it started. And what I actually want to share here also is that I took a lot of time, to develop, for introspection personally in my Auroville years, to think, but also to rethink things. And that's, like I said, to devote the time towards becoming and towards advancing. And, there is no shortcut. It's not going to be easy, right, to do this kind of huge project like Auroville. But it's an opportunity. And I think we need, it was something that I gave a lot of time to, and I still give a lot of time to. And it has been very rewarding. So, this taking time also had to do with this kind of thoughts, that there is nothing so useless as doing efficiently that which should not be done at all. This is by Peter Drucker, this sentence. I used to have these thoughts in the early years in Auroville, when we were doing all kinds of things. Also, I had the time to think, about what's going on in the planet. So through that, I managed to actually organize my work and from this perspective and present it in Louisiana. I have put together a couple of images which I could run by if you would like.
Yeah, just run a few by and then you can run some more later on.
Okay. I wanted to, you know, coming from India, I wanted to show that cities and good projects, they take lifetimes to create. And I wanted to also explain to, you know, that I didn't feel like I should start with myself as an architect. There was already architects of previous generations. People know I worked for many years. I wanted to continue working with my seniors. And, you know, I have spent a lot of my time to understand what Roger had envisaged. And I also feel that my students and the future generation, we all ought to be in tune, and we can't keep starting from ourselves. So that is something I try to bring out here, and also to explain that all over the world, we have our hurry is creating a lot of social, economic, and environmental problems. These are all man-made constructs. It is a result of how we are approaching habitat in the world. And in that kind of context, I have a couple of, it's a huge exhibition. So there are different rooms, but there's one Wunderkammer. It's a collection of all kinds of items. I've called it the architecture of time, where I've sorted out, you know, before humans existed and before even organisms existed, architecture already existed. Architects didn't exist, but architecture existed in the way I said time is the architect. This section is called Architecture of Time because we're talking about evolution. So here are objects which explain how matter evolved. So there are three sections based on many things I read from the synthesis of yoga, etc. Matter, life, and mind. So I have looked at the architecture of matter, and I have put in all kinds of beautiful objects which are self-explanatory. All kinds of complex problems have been already solved by over time, that those have come, you know, structures exist. And the relationship, you know, between matter and space in the DNA of every organism, in the cells, there is an architecture programmed already. So in life, there is already, we can take lessons from street patterns and, you know, like the wings or our arteries and veins, they are all the same, you know. So I've put in all kinds of very fascinating objects in the Wunderkammer, where I talk about the architecture of matter, the architecture of life, the architecture of mind. And I explain the challenge of the human mind and the construct, you know, that we as humans, there is life in us and there is architecture in us. And we are part of that, that reflects all the universal laws like gravity and every other thing. And there is a total harmony in all of that. And yet the mind, which is also at work, it has to develop as well, but the mind has also created constructs, you know, like this is the mind area. And how the evolution of the human mind has created, with the thinking hand, it has created tools, and how the tools we create shape us back. So it's very important what we make, you know, and the cities we create, because they create us. So when we make something, we actually make ourselves. It's even in anthropology spoken that way, homo faber. So, you know, I've put us in perspective. Where do we stand? How are we positioning ourselves towards what we are making? And how is it going to make us back? There is this section of things we have. I have organized sections where, you know, every material taken out of the Wunderkammer, like, let me say, and natural materials, or the context from where you draw a material and how you shape it back with the architecture. So my projects are put together material palette of researches that I have done over many, many years, where I'm not talking on material research alone, but also how the human was involved in the technologies that we created. So, you know, some of my works are kind of arranged section by section, terracotta, you know. And there are, what is interesting here are technical systems that technological aspects have been also built in large models. So yeah, you have some of all the researches I did up us explain. There's this Wunderkamma, which is a philosophical reflection, but connecting the idea of evolution and how time passes and what we do today and things like that. But it comes down to material researches, including large scale, all these models, you know, technical models. This is a recent project. Maybe I'll just show that I've done in Pondicherry. It's a daycare center, just completed last year or this year even, you know. And this, these are, for example, the terracotta things. Actually, Sonali, yeah, and Yashoda, they are very much part of this project. In fact, this is very much Sonali's contribution. As you can see, she has done in the archive building as well. But so, yeah, we are, it's a collaborative practice that we've been running. And yeah, I mean, see, there are too many images there. So I can just, I could leave it at this for now, you know, and sure, speak about it. You can see it's goes into technology, but it's very philosophical as well.
Okay, Tuan, why don't you?
No, I find this an incredibly interesting subject because usually architecture is about space. And you have brought in the dimension of time, which some philosophers consider time as the fourth dimension of space. So it, you have written about, I read a note that you prepared.
Mm-hmm.
That, for example, architecture must stand the test of time. You have said somewhere else, architecture of life and architecture of time. You have spoken about from making time to taking time.
Yeah.
Which I would recommend you add a third one, giving time, which you are doing right now. So thank you so much. And to be with time. We have to be with time. But what is very interesting about time, there are some philosophers who say time does not exist, right? The whole existence is one moment, but because the mind cannot grasp it all, we see it in sequences. So there is one philosophy which says that sequences are actually man-made. Time is man-made. But that in fact, there is no such thing as time. But about that, we can talk another time. I would like to ask you, my first question is, when you say architecture must stand the test of time, could you elaborate a little bit on what you mean with that statement?
I mean that actually, when I meant it in the light of sustainability, actually, because I'm quite disturbed that sustainability is almost like a new green religion right now, where it is looked upon as a very, like, this is a, it's like a religious kind of a pigeonholing of materials. Like, this is a good material, that is a bad material, and things like that, you know. And there are criteria, and there are all kinds of points. And I think sustainability is about whether your ideas will sustain, whether it's economically, environmentally, socially, whatever. What I wanted to say is standing the test of time is, if you look at, see, we may, our lives are short and we will be no more, but whatever we made, it stays there. Like the first, how, you know, those, look at all this architecture and Jinji or whatever we make, you know, if you compare it with what we're making now, all these glass towers, you know, sometimes they are like one hit wonder. Everybody starts with themselves, produce some huge towers very rapidly, and they are going to, they, the people will pass away, the architects will pass away. These objects will be haunting us. or giving us a nice heritage? And that is the question of whether, and not only that, the people who spend their time, their short time on earth, has it been rewarding for them if they were making this or they were making that? And that is what I mean. Is it standing the test of time for the others, but also for yourself? What you did, was it rewarding? So I want to actually, my short answer to what you asked is that I'm actually appealing to people to see, not only inhabit your space consciously, but also inhabit your time. As an architect, I think we have to be present and not think we are eternal, because in that thinking, sometimes we are not doing anything in the moment to moment to moment, which will constantly shape our, you know, 30 years later. And when that kind of attitude brings so much delay, we are all suffering, actually, if we are not progressing.
You know, sometimes we have discussions here also in Horrible Consulting about the difference between vision and mission. And I always say that vision is timeless, because you don't say vision accomplished, you say mission accomplished, right? Mm-hmm. So the vision has got that timelessness, and that's maybe what you also indicate when you say architecture must stand the test of time. Architecture can stand the test of time if it is vision driven, because a vision is timeless. It is something you have seen. And then in order to realize the vision, you have a mission, you have a strategy, you have plans, etc. But the vision itself is timeless. So if you take Auroville as a program, as a project, I would say that the dream that the mother gave and the charter are the vision. And then the true Aurovillian could be considered as the value system. And then the plans come to implement that vision and to implement all those values. But the vision is timeless. Similarly, if you take the example of Auroville's the galaxy plan, the galaxy concept is timeless. The implementation will take time. So perhaps when you say architecture must stand the test of time, could I translate this by saying that architecture which is vision driven will definitely stand the test of time? Would that be a right way to interpret that statement?
Yeah, I think so. I in fact would, even if you know, sometimes the word vision has also become like a very heavy word for many people, you know, but when we repeat sometimes, see, in an age, sorry, but I think when there is a situation of polarity, everybody make any word becomes stuck, you know. The word is actually free, but we make associations in a polarized society that we cannot talk really freely about our own goals. And I think even I'm just purposely using the word goals to dodge it, you know, the heaviness of the vision. But I agree that if we don't take the time to look if our steps are probably going in the opposite direction of our own goal, that is a frustration, you know. And I think that that's what I meant by taking time also, that, you know, look, we can, it's an illusion if we think that the individual goals are in differing direction, because in fact it's an illusion that we are not one. That is an illusion. We see in COVID times that we are one. Anything that happens to anyone, it happens to everyone. So it's a kind of individualistic kind of you know, some myths are created, you know, as if we would be pulling in different directions and things like that. I found often very difficult to even start a discussion in our Auroville context, because I really don't see the thing like there are two ways or two things, the pro and the against and all. It's that itself is an illusion, I feel, because I think we are actually a collective, and no matter where you are, not only in Auroville, the whole world, I'm saying. So anyway, if we want to accept it, good. If we don't, then anyway, we are biologically, we are anyway evolving in spite of us. But if we want to go because of us, we will suffer less. And then we have to start to value the unity and of our goal, collective goal.
So, Anu, would you just, at one point you mentioned something about time in different layers, the way you were looking at time in different layers and how it is an evolutionary momentum, the way you saw it. I'm sorry, I just took it off from Torn.
Yeah.
Did you want to?
No, I haven't put a kind of solution there. I have just shared my reflections, and I've sorted, when I said the architecture of time, etc., I've shown all these objects that you see in the world only to let us realize our insignificance and then also realize our relevance. But, you know, we have to realize that it is again the way we take time and what we do with it, that whether we are insignificant or we are, you know, I mean, I discovered after living in Auroville, and in fact, one of the reasons I produced the Auroville project, the Line of Goodwill in Louisiana, is because I wanted to see the, you know, the delicious feeling when you have the power that you have a thought and it's not met with resistance. You know, there is a power, you know, of the unresisted thought. And that is something to be experienced. And I am, the reason I wanted to move away is because after a couple of years of this going on, debating and resisting, I want to experience that, you know, and I have tried to, you know, work in context where that can be celebrated, actually. You know, and I would like to eventually discuss all those type of things, you know, that
shall we take a few more pictures, maybe come to the Line of Goodwill, you know, your different
I'm just maybe going to flip just certain wait I'm just going okay I'm just okay. flipping some of the images, okay, what, because these are projects that have been shown there, including the future town hall. In the front, you know, you see there is a main town hall that I have planned. That other one was called Town Hall Annex. So we spent a lot of resources making very huge models and explaining all the breakthroughs made in these projects, you know, the big cantilevers that were achieved and how from, which many people don't know how much concrete is saved and through what kind of human ingenuities and collaborations behind it, and the latest works that I'm doing with ferrocement, where I'm trying to use, you know, for disaster relief and structures, casting them on corrugated paper. You know, all these are projects that people have seen of mine here and there, but they don't realize that these are prototypes for very, very important kind of future, you know, potential. So anyway, I'm just going to skip all this. But there is a lot of engineering, lab testing, etc., also being done for my prototypes, which stand around in Auroville. But yeah, so this room explains all that, and it demystifies technologies, including cements, concretes, etc., for the common man, for everybody, actually, to not outsource the habitat to others, you know, but to be involved in it. So anyway, I'm going to just come here towards Auroville. So you see,
John, would you like to come in at this point?
No, I just wanted to say something about, in electricity, we have conductors and resistors, right?
Sorry?
Electricity, you have conductors.
yeah. Resistance.
Reflecting on the following thoughts, that you could consider time as a conductor, or you could consider time as a resistor. And when time is a resistor, you have delay. But if you go with the flow of time, then you treat time as a conductor.
Yeah.
So this is a thought which came while you were speaking, that we should have time as our partner, as a conductor, and not as a resistor.
You know, in fact, it's so true. I love this, the way you have put it. I have also explained that to take time is to be alive. As living beings, the meaning of our lives come from the way we spend our time. We can reverse the notion that time is running out by getting time on our side and befriending it. We must not race against time, but build a good relationship with the time of our own life. And that's what I mean. Instead of trying to make time, we should take time, you know?
Don't forget to give time.
Don't.
Yeah. And so anyway.
Time I want to share with you, since we were on the subject of electricity. You know, power is measured in watts, right? Power.
Yes.
Or in kilowatts. And energy is power multiplied by time, kilowatt hour. So it's very interesting that without time, there's no energy. Without time, there's only power. So you have, say, 1 kilowatt means tau, you know, but if you don't switch it on and that time pass, there's no energy being generated. So it's very interesting that you need time to get energy. Otherwise, you only have idle power. Power is, energy is power multiplied by time, kilowatt hour.
Yeah, wow, very interesting. Tuan, please do a special lecture on electricity. No, it's true, because that's all there is, the energy, you know.
Yes. And
very, you've given me very new, I'll call you later for this discussion.
Yeah, we will elaborate.
Okay.
So anyway, before I go to the Auroville projects, I just want to also just say that, you know, this ferrocement, which of course I discovered in Auroville after I had learnt about Pierre Luigi Nervi, and you know, I have built upon all the researches that were being done here in Auroville, and looking at Roger's Auro Model houses and CSR and all the experimentation that happened here. And I still think that it's a very versatile material. And I have produced, modular housing systems for high-rise, assembly of high-rise housing. And I had a vision for that, you know, we could use the time of the, the way these houses are made, these are not prefabricated in regular factories. But I wanted for Auroville to have a concept of city construction that is silent and not noisy, and that all the various villages surrounding Auroville, including the Auroville residents, can make small modules and in the backyards of their houses, etc., and these can be assembled. So it's a prefabricated, high-tech looking housing system, but it is in fact a modular system of storage. And it can be put up very quickly, but the way this is made, it includes the time of the people in the local area, and it could be a way forward. It's a social sustainability strategy for using people's time fruitfully to empower themselves to make their own habitat and to do it noiselessly. That was my aim. So this system is shown here, and after, there are kitchen units and very specific units. You just put them up. It takes about a week to assemble this unit maximum. And it's built in 1-to-1 scale. And so from that room, you look down at a gallery. So this was a second room. Actually, there are already two rooms before this. This is the third room. And from there, when you look down and come down, actually, I have staged this area to show that is a single unit in the line of goodwill, okay? And there is a timeline that they have created here. When you enter this, descend this down this room, there is a timeline of the Auroville context, you know, starting on the left, you can recognize the galaxy plan there. And you can see the first sketch of Auroville. Then there is a video there of Roger speaking. So you hear the bird sounds of Auroville, you feel you're in Auroville. There's a huge 6 meter high, 20 meter long projection of Auroville horizon. And you see the evolution of the city and Roger's work and his voice. And down you see there are some images of my collaboration with him. And it shows all my projects in the timeline. And then it goes down to showing my last work that I've been doing. These are huge models, by the way. All these models I've shown you, they are like huge and heavy. They are cast in so to be durable for a long time, monsoon proof, very expensive. Anyway, so these are explaining how the low rise and the high rise will work together, and how it's not a tower which abruptly lands on the ground. But because of the new mobility, because of the non-ownership quality, and the fact that human scale is something we are achieving in a compact small city, these are the three areas of innovation and why it could be relevant for the rest of the world if Auroville fulfills its vision. And so it shows that sort of thing. And it shows some of my researches done with people like Jan Gehl, the mobility expert. When I was a professor in Stuttgart, my students had done this work and we used to call him. But the rest of the room, you can get a sense of this. This model is 20 meters long. It's, I don't know what to do with it after January, because sadly, maybe if it doesn't go to other exhibitions, it's like too huge to take anywhere. But the pedestrian concept of the streets that I have envisioned at from ground floor to first, second, third, fourth floor of a rising hillscape, where you don't, because there are no cars, so very different things are allowable. There is no land devoted to any mobility. It's inside the footprint. You walk on the roofs in a meditative way, or you walk on the intermediate level, which is more social with all the facilities and shops and everything. And the houses open directly to the green. There is no space taken for a paving. So those kind of concepts have been elaborated. And inside my urban design, which is really huge, I've also taken rocks and benches and everything. See, look, there is a fourth floor, maximum high fourth floor, of a public street space so that children can walk safely home from the city when they go to the schools, etc. So to create that, to enact that, we have made the actual floor of the building. We are on the fourth floor. And we've got these rocks and landscaping, and we see the outside time lapse. You can see Auroville, this dawn begins till it becomes lit again. You know, so all the colors keep changing and you feel you're in Auroville. There are sounds, etc. So my students from Yale University, where I was teaching till last semester, Potsdam, where I'm now a professor, and local Copenhagen students have contributed. I have sort of helped them to do mini co-housing projects of 60 to 80 residents who share different things. And that has been plugged in to all these projects. And you see this purple line, which cuts through. There's a kind of mobility that is designed within the curve. But there is a slow movement, but there are also fast vertical tracks. But it's just a very, very different kind of habitat that is envisioned, keeping the India's density in mind and in order to conserve the greens. If we don't go for high rise, I'm afraid we make more and more gated colony communities, and it will become like Berlin. Everything will be 3-4 stories and we won't have the greens that we planted. So it's very important that if you make one line of this sort, you can have 4 times our population. I mean, 8,000 people can fit here in only 800 meter long infrastructure cables with bicycle paths under it and car sharing, and everything will be fitted over there. You have from the lowest rise density to the highest rise experiments to be made. And you can actually negotiate between high rise and high tech and low tech. All aspects can be done here. Totally, our population will become over 10,000, but we will have only kept our construction area to only 800 meter long. It will span from visitor center to Matri Mandir. From the most peripheral relationship to guide all these huge overwhelming crowds, they will all be contained in the bottom of this building. And, I think it could help Auroville take a next bold leap and open the doors to all the men of goodwill who got invited here, who are waiting to come. So yeah, so this is the sort of scale, you know, at which, and you see, if you build something of this dimension, then any kind of project fits every architectural kind of thing, as long as it is collective minded. Every type of expression is possible. And even though it looks very huge, actually it's very, very small, human scale. Sorry, it's going too long, huh?
No. I just wanted Jaya to come in because she's here and she's part of the line project.
So please.
Come in, yeah. And then continue, please.
No. Jaya, please.
Yeah, Jaya, come in.
Yeah, actually, what you're talking about is what I want to be hearing. Now, we have spoken about this together before. I feel very concerned about the situation in India with the high rise, because India is one of the countries which has a very fast moving population, no? And also is the home for many species which are very important to us, no? Just, I don't know what to say, even emotionally. Elephant, tigers, etc. All dependent on habitat and habitat sizes. And we are really diminishing and trying to almost see what is the smallest possible to make them, you know, survive. And it doesn't work like that. So when we are looking, for me, when we look at the lines of force, it's really a way to see how can we, who can adapt so easily compared to the animals, because actually we are the most invasive and adaptable species now. How can we consciously project the future? And I thought when you said this thing about the tools we make are actually affecting, how do you say, who we are, what we do, what becomes, no? And I know that in from Roche you also, because Roche was really working with this human scale in the high rise, in the works he was doing. So maybe you can even go a little bit more deeply into talk about these aspects, you know, of the land. Because sometimes when one looks at the model, one sees that there is still a lot of low buildings, but how do we keep, for example, in Oroville, our forests even inside the city today?
If we don't build these lines of force, if we continue the habit we have now of making all the small plots, and, you know, can you ask Tuan, like for 2,000 people or maybe 3,000 today, how much was the length of every cable possible, etc.? How much, and have you seen everybody's jogging alongside cars and bikes and all that? So what is the cost of spreading out? I mean, you know, the point is, I think if we want to preserve the greens and the forests, etc., you know, we should not assume that just because today it looks green in some patches, that it will be so. Because look at all our housing projects. If we follow that model to arrive at 50,000, there will be no land left. Only now we are dreaming. Look at Muthialpet. It was not looking like that, right, when we got there. It all looked very green and empty. It looked like barren land. So this is going to happen. So that's what I mean. It's like putting like ostriches, you know, looking into our spot. We need to zoom out. We don't have to do anything. We just look, when you look from the air, when you land in Pondicherry, you can see what is happening. For those who can't see it on the spot, we feel like it's a nostalgia, you know, that is making us feel that if we resist the city, we will have all the green. It's the opposite. Just for a moment, I know it's hard to imagine, but for a moment, imagine we build this 800 meter long structure. And all of us, instead of building Matri Mandir, build there. All architects have all projects there. I'm not saying to forbid anything, okay? There can everything coexist, but I mean as a big project. Imagine low rise from ground plus 1 to 3 to 4, whoever believes in 6 to 8, 14, whatever you want, do it there. All the shops, everything. Everything will be close to everything. 8,000 people will fit there. We have calculated the infrastructure cost. Imagine the 10,000 people will live in this city by the time this is finished. All the rest is green. But if you make little patches here, we will go with our cars, with our taxis from here to there and there. Can you count how much is the road surface that is not green because of us spreading? It's a lot. Oroville has the highest infrastructure proportion to the number of inhabitants and the maximum land consumption. So in India, if you use this amounts of land for such few people, it's not a sustainable model, I feel. Actually, and that's why I have worked in this direction.
Actually, you can even take it one step further. That if we continue in the present scenario, we will have a suburban density in the city, yeah, and city density outside the city.
Yeah, I think this is absolutely.
And we will not have the critical mass that we need to make the minimum experiment, because I think Oroville was envisioned so that we could radically rethink education, economy, everything. But if we want to, and the governance, if we just are a handful of people, and we have a governance that is based on keeping the day-to-day affairs, manage only that, then what do we do? we are going to only further our own habits and crystallize them with much more, you know, machinery behind. So I think I know it is hard to imagine. It's outside the comfort zone, but that's the project Auroville was. I remember you said, right, Tuan, that it's one of the zones that was not planned in Auroville, the comfort zone.
Yes.
Okay, Jaya has one more thing.
No, and it's on the same line. It's the fact that we look very much strongly at planting trees and sometimes to exchange the city for a forest. But the fact is that if we don't show how you can build a city so that forest can be kept,
yes,
it we are not doing what we have to do in relation to nature. No?
Yeah.
We are here to build a city to start with, but even in the relation to nature and what has been done, which is so beautiful, if we are not showing how we can keep the sustainability in relation to that, we are not doing our work.
But also I'm more concerned, more than the actual physical development of the city, I'm more concerned that if we don't concentrate, then we don't develop a city. To be a city, it means to develop a civic sense. It means to realize that we are one and that we have collective, we have individual differences, but the collective works together, the water, the energy, everything, the streets, the movement. If we don't do that, we have all the disharmony that we have because we live in our own bubbles. And the whole thing is, this is the essential thing I feel that we all suffer from, is that we feel that, but I think what is behind it is actually a fear because of old notions of cities. But right from the very beginning, what I understood with whatever work we did with Roger is that everything was always conceived, and that's the quote I have used of his in that exhibition, is that it was conceived as one organism. That's what makes a city distinct. It's like one biological organism. It cannot function if in separate parts are not there for themselves. And that's why some people find it hard to imagine, because they always compare old city studies, etc. And then they say that, oh, there is not enough knowledge to do that. But the old knowledges have served those cities, but we are at a crossroad. Everyone is talking about it. And at least we should not repeat that if we don't know what to do. Either we do the new thing or we halt. But if you repeat that, you will take a wonderful platform or a new opportunity, and we will, it will look charming now, but very soon we can see already that if these habits are perpetuating, we know what the future looks like.
Anu, one more question. I just want to check if there's any comments or questions coming in. Can you just check so that in case we need to respond to people? Is there something up there? Not yet. Okay, people are just listening.
Okay, maybe I just show you one thing, because Tuan spoke about electricity. I just want to show you one aspect. I mean, they have also shown other housing projects I have done, so that everything doesn't look like just a dreaming thing, but there are some couple of housing projects achieved in the same direction of what was tested here, of upper level walkways, etc. And so what is interesting is that here, if you look at just like there was a one-to-one scale housing unit explained, there is a facade of the future, the new face of human habitat that we are assuming what it could become. That has been shown in one-to-one, but on a scaffolding to show it's like a brainstorming. So here what we have is, you know, this pink wall, Tuan, that is a, and some of those are solar, these are power generating facades of the latest generation that are embedded in the ferrocement. These are some German producers. These are new generation solar panels, which can be, you know, not only kept as panels like infrastructure outside, it's part of the organism. The skin is like a glowworm. It should be able to give light, you know, water. So there are three or four concepts, you know, in that facade, which we have developed. And I'll just show you what I've built upon Roger Anger's studies to defragment, not to have a thin skin and you don't know how many towers, how many floors and towers of glass, etc. Instead, it's broken down to the individual cell. and the facade studies are done along with the climatic knowledge. And there are three broad ideas I'm researching. One of them is energy generating option integrated into the materiality of the skin. One third is dedicated to that, the right. So a face is broken up in order to break it to many more facets so that the right facet faces the sun, and that's where you harvest sun. The other side is a green screen, because the future cities are going to be generators of water and wastewater. So farming should be done on the spot. So these are incorporated as a skin element to give shade and all that. And the third is that the one third is absorbing urban waste into building. And so these three are shown in these facets in full scale, whatever where our research is right now. We have worked with Transolar climate engineers, and we have worked with, you know, this. So this whole room is dedicated to co-creation and collaboration, and not the usual way of architectural production. So there are students, academic institutions, you know, water engineer, climate engineer, from the beginning of, you know, the first, you know, conception stage. And those kind of concepts are integrated, the greens, the food growing, all of that, you know. And there is also this, we have taken one material to research here, which is waste denim, because India makes jeans for the rest of the planet. And all these pieces are left behind, but there are hundreds of things like that. So they have to, so this is done in collaboration with Naushad Ali, with whom I've been working for a while. And he has, you know, built upon other works. We are trying to use them in the architecture. There are solar you know, cells being, you know, the idea of decentralized small pieces making up the unity is also reflected symbolically in all our design elements. So, you know, all the little things add up, you know. So, yeah. And here are some other things we are doing with urban waste. These are furniture, you know, these are sofas for books, you know. In one room where the film is shown, and this is the last image I have actually, people are using this furniture. You know,
can we extend? Okay, Anu, I'll just interrupt you.
Yes.
I have a little comment from Srivatsa, which says, "Hi, Anu, great to know your work and congratulations on the exhibition. As an Aurevillian, having experimented with local materials, currently having a broad understanding about, I'm sure, the current paradoxes." Okay. Hope that you are well aware about the current paradoxes, I guess, in Auroville. Personally, I see the galaxy has immense possibility to create interesting technologies. Do you think currently we are doing enough research and prototypes in Auroville on material research? If not, what would you suggest to regenerate the sector? Okay, now the thing is, Anu, we are completely out of time, are we? Okay, we can continue for 1 or 2 minutes. I think we have to absolutely do another session and go into specifics. And there is something else which I, you know, because there is this whole thing about materials, this whole thing about energy. I also wanted to bring in this question about what is Auroville's real cluster, and to look at the line of force as a cluster, which is something which is has the capacity to solve many issues about the city and life, as well as to evolve. So these are questions which will come up in the next session. We'll have to sit with you and plan how to do that. Tuan, would you have something to say?
No, maybe I just want to ask our team, can we do another 10 minutes extra or not?
Okay.
Yeah, we can go. We have no problem. No, because last time we had some. So we can continue. Anu, you please complete your presentation.
Yeah.
No, there's only one last image, but I do want to, I appreciate Srivatsa, we haven't met. You ask me if I'm aware of Auroville's paradoxes. I have to say no. I was, when I used to suffer, I was suffering. I was in that, but I really so moved on in my own consciousness, I suppose, that I don't actually see it like that anymore. I just feel that see, everything we imagine we can do. Maybe we can't do it exactly somewhere or somewhere else, or, you know, I'm not frustrated about all that. I'm so excited about what I see and what I have spent my time on, and especially the time for working with Roger, because the questions were so hard and our solutions were falling short. That's why we are not able to do more. But whenever you have a solution, I noticed, see, like I have these ideas I've been working on. It's not got waste, you know. I could build all this, you know. Some people put a lot of resources at my service, you know, to be able to help me to see for myself what those ideas are. So I just feel everything is all fine how it is. And I think everybody is responsible to, it's not going to be an easy path. And I mean, I'm very intrigued by the question. And even if we don't solve it, we can't stop thinking about it. So I would, that's the only last image I wanted to offer here, is I think that, you know, the process is very important. There is, and not just the product. So we can't just invest in the fruits. We want, you know, I want us to invest in the roots. That's what I want to say. That's what I've done. I've spent a lot of time to keep the frontier tips of the root alive, that it keeps on investigating all the different directions, you know, water, energy, this, that, every aspect, and architecture. And I think it's the idea is synthesis, even in a collective, you know, the idea is the trunk of the tree brings all this together. And then the fruits come out of that. So the process is something to invest in. I have made time for processes. And I have, for me, it has been very personally rewarding. I may not see, you know, yes. And regarding the last point, yes, it is met with resistance. No doubt. But my grandfather had told me long ago that if you have never met with resistance, then consider your idea irrelevant. Because whenever you will do something new, you will be met with resistance. So of course I want to survive. So I keep on going to a fertile ground to survive. But if you invest in the root, if there is a cyclone, the tree will come up again. We cannot say the same if you just do the, you know, the shortcut way. So yeah, I mean, I hope I have been able to explain this, but I mean, I'm feeling also very, very happy, you know, to share this work, because I have suffered in the past, not because of the polarized climate, where we were not able, I have not been able to share my work. I think Roger has not been able to share his work. I've seen him not being able to just simply share to curious people what he has envisioned. Similarly, I'm also curious about other people's imagination. But there is a climate of fear where people are not sharing visions. The energy and action is put in pulling down the shortcoming of someone's vision. But that's a fear-based reaction. And I think if you have an open mind, you can just talk about things, because we are not so different from each other, ultimately.
Great. Thank you, Anu.
Thank you so
can
much.
We, any closing remarks?
Yes, I might want to make a request to Anu.
Yes.
You have shown these very big models, right?
Yes.
But they're not big enough. So what I would request you is, because you know the airlines are very desperate for business, right? So you could actually prepare the building blocks of Auroville itself where you are.
Yes.
And we can have the airlines bring them free of cost to Auroville, and we can just install them.
Oh my God, I thought you said that to build it there, one-to-one.
Yes.
You're saying that?
It's a building block, because you're almost there. You have already a good scale, right? A little bit bigger, but that is in a lighter vein. But what I want to say is that it is so nice to see these incredible models there. You know, Roger always worked with models. I mean, he was making much more models than drawings. He was a three-dimensional architect. I mean, he used to work with sculpture and with models. So it is very nice to see the models that you have shown. And I think, as Anu said, we should have another session at least to elaborate further and to answer to the question that Srivatsa asked, namely, what more research can we do to, you know, manifest the galaxy? What more do we have to do? You have done an incredible amount of research already. You have translated that research in those beautiful three-dimensional models. What more can we do, even for the other zones? And there, in that connection, I want to make one comment also, which is that Roger had shared with us several times that the two most difficult zones to realize are the international and the cultural, right? Because there you have many options. The residential is relatively easier to manifest, and the industrial. So can we do some research together on how to manifest the four zones in the context of the galaxy? And perhaps with the tools that you have developed, we can actually visualize them in real models.
I would like to say that to Srivatsan also, for a long, long time, I felt that we need some other research more and this and that, you know, professional and all that. I really don't believe that we need any of that, because even long ago, all that would have been already possible, because, you know, Roger already came with that. And even not only Roger, there were so many engineers, Tuan, you know how many people we used to meet. I don't think it's a professional research required. I think this is a myth. We are fooling ourselves. So we keep waiting. We can wait for Godot, because the technologies will keep advancing. Every day we have not, acted upon our wishes or aspiration, will be more researchers out there to incorporate. So I don't see it that way. I think, and Roger also said, I think the main thing we actually need in Auroville to realize Auroville is the goodwill. Just the goodwill. And because I'm not saying it's not there. But if we recognize that in us, instead of the part in us which fears the action of the other, you know, in that newspaper, the Danish newspaper where they interviewed me, the last few lines, I kind of liked that they picked that from my talk. I said, you know, why did I do this work? Many people were telling me, why am I doing this futile work? You know, of course, I have this picture in front of me always. I can't not do it. Okay. Why am I doing it? Because if I would sit and complain about how things are, I would feel like a victim of circumstances. But I don't feel like a victim. I never felt like a victim of the action of someone else. And I don't think they are a victim of my action. I'm creating. If I start creating, if I make models and all that, what happens is I see where I have to create more, or I start acting. So I urge everybody to create instead of to block the action of someone else. I urge people, follow your aspiration. We are all there for our aspiration and we will contribute. If you create, you will stop being a victim. It's a highly empowering thing. So because I have done all this work, many people have asked me that I should be frustrated. You know, since I cannot show all this in Auroville, I am not. I'm very rewarded because my capacity grew because I have to solve this engineer. I have to do mobility thing. I knew nothing about it. Now I do know a lot about it because I kept solving it. So today I feel empowered. So I'm happy who I became.
From Jaya.
No, I just wanted to say something.
Okay, just something from Jaya.
I just wanted to, for one thing, to encourage people who are out there and who can travel, which we can't right now, to go to Luciana and see the exhibition.
Yes, I'm doing that.
If I get a chance before the 31st of January, I will be there and I hope to sit there with you and some other people also, because I think it is a tremendously important thing.
Yeah.
And I really look forward to this exhibition and the conversations which it will open up will bring us to move faster with this line of goodwill, because I think we should not be dawdling on this one. It's really important. Mm-hmm. And it's in the doing. When you say about the research, I feel that the research is actually the doing and the living and the movement. That's where the research is. It involves.
And may I just add just one more thing, that I have also made one board over there saying, no, Auroville is not utopia. It's a laboratory. Utopia is where you never want to achieve. You put your ideals so high that you can remain banal day to day. I'm saying, no, it's a laboratory. And there's a board which says celebrating imperfect action. It's the action that makes you.
But not only that, there is actually a movement in Auroville right now, that people actually have realized if we want to move forward, then we have to work together with other people who have slightly different opinions, but actually only we can move things forward if we do it together. So something of this has, through this COVID situation, actually started to happen, which is very beautiful.
And I also would like to add something to that discussion about research. It is indeed not the traditional professional research which is needed.
Yes.
Because if it is a city which is based on a vision, in fact, if the city itself is a vision, it is more a process of discovery. You discover the vision, and that you do indeed by doing.
Yes.
Right? So it is a discovery rather than a research.
There's a subjectivity in experimenting.
Yes. You have to be ready for a couple of failures, no problem. But you have to go on.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes.
Anu,
thank you so much.
Thank you so much for joining us, and we hope to see you again very soon. Take time, take rest. It's been a huge work. Congratulations. And we'll get back to you again.
Thank you so much, and please organize a session with Tuan about electricity, because it's a really, let's tap that source.
Yes, we do it.
Very good. Yeah. Okay.
Okay, take care.
Yeah.
Okay. Bye. Bye.